go ahead and get started. We're going to go ahead and stand as we sing hymn number 187, At Calvary, is what we're singing this morning. Years I spent in vanity and pride. Sing it out with us.
Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified.
Of you here today, trust that you've come desiring a blessing from God's word, and you want to focus upon him today. It's all about him, not about us. We want to honor the Lord Jesus. So thank you for being here today. If you're visiting with us, I want to say thank you very much and hope that you received a visitor's card when you came in. Please drop that in the offering plate or give it to one of the ushers or myself when you leave today. We love having visitors, and we have them from all over the world. We appreciate you so much being here today. We've got a busy day today. We've got the Lord's table, we've got two young men that are following the Lord in believers' baptism, and we've got a shower this afternoon and a service tonight. So things are busy here at First Baptist Church, and we praise the Lord for the strength to get things done, but because of our schedules coming up in the month of August, we've got to get some of these things done. So let's look to the Lord in a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for all that you're doing in our church and in our church family. Lord, we do pray for those especially today that have lost loved ones over the last month and a half. We've had a lot of memorial services. We pray that your peace and comfort would be their portion. Lord, we thank you for the folks that are visiting with us today. We pray that they'd be able to leave here and know that we love your son and we seek to exalt him. And Lord, work in our lives. Our theme this year is that you might increase, we might decrease. Today we're asking that you would help our faith to increase, that we would be men and women of faith, that we would trust your word and act upon it. Please bless this service today. Bless your people. Encourage their hearts. But most of all, more than anything else, we ask that you would exalt your son, for it's in his name we pray. Amen. Let's greet one another at this time. If you're not shaking hands, just keep your hand to your side. But if you are, welcome our visitors.
Make your way back to your places. We're going to get started with the next song, The Love of God. Make your way back to your places. Hymn 286 in your hymn books. We We have a shortened song service today because of the stuff we're doing this right after the service. The love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. Hymn 286, the love of God. Sing it out with us as you make your way back to your places.
The love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty bear bound down with care, God gave His Son to win. His erring child
to our course of the month for this month. It's some trust in chariots and some in horses. This is actually a song in the Bible. Some trust in chariots and some in horses. Sing it out with us.
Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we will remember the name of the Lord our God. Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we will remember the name of the Lord our God. Now I know that the Lord saved His anointed. He will hear Him from His holy heaven with the saving strength of His right hand. They are brought down and fallen, but we are risen and stand upright. Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we will remember the name of the Lord our God. Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we will remember the name of the Lord our God. We will remember the name of the Lord our God.
Great singing, you may be seated. We're going to have our announcements at this time.
Before we do our announcements, stay standing up, Pastor Caleb. Many of you know that there's a pretty good fire east of town, and a lot of our men, our firemen, are out this morning. They're fighting that blaze. They brought in a slurry bomber last night, but they weren't able to get that out. I'm going to just ask if Caleb would lead us in a short word of prayer that God would keep the men of our church that serve our community as firemen safe.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for this day. We're thankful that we have men here in First Baptist and in this community that are willing to volunteer to go fight these fires for us. Lord, thank you for their willingness to go. Thank you for their courage. Lord, we ask that you put a hedge of protection around each and every one of them as they fight this fire. Lord, I ask that you help put it out fast. Lord, I ask that you give wisdom to them as they fight it. Lord, I ask that you put it out today, Lord, if it's your will. And Lord, we ask that you keep everyone safe. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Continue to pray for those men. They've been overworked the last month or so. It's been a dangerous time. We had a wonderful reception here for the Daniels family. The flowers in front of the pulpit are a gift from the Daniels family. I think our ladies fed about 120, 130 people yesterday. Ladies, thank you so much for all that you do to minister to these families, and appreciate so much your willingness to do that. Right after the service this morning, we do have a baby shower in honor of Ashton and little Faye, and so ladies, you're welcome to stay. There's a lunch and serve for the ladies. Men, you're on your own today. So, and then this coming Wednesday, we have a meal fellowship here. We meet at 6 o'clock before the Bible study at 7 and have a time of food and fellowship. Want to encourage you about that. I received an invitation this week on August the 22nd. I'll get it said right. Sunday afternoon from 1 to 3 at the Hot Springs Senior Citizen Center. There will be a 100th birthday party for Florence Toots Doherty. And so we want to encourage all of you on the 22nd to slip over to the Hot Springs Senior Citizen. And Miss Toots is one of the few people that I know that can say to Frank, how you doing, young fella? So anyway, so it. So we're glad for that. One other thing I want to mention, and then I'm going to turn it over to Pastor Caleb. He's got a couple things that he would like to mention to you. Do be much in prayer. We've got two more funerals this week. On Thursday at 2 o'clock at the Days Inn, I'll be doing a service for Sam Marshall, and that's open to the church family. If you knew Sam was very involved with our historical society here in town, and very involved, so I know Carol and Joe would appreciate that. And then on Saturday at 2 p.m. at the church, there will be a service for Don Gorley, and I talked with his sister. That's also open. If you knew Jack and Charlotte Gorley, our new Don, you're more than welcome to come. It'll be just a brief affair, but they would love to have you come if you would like to. It's good to have Josh and Margaret Marco back. They've been away for a little time. They just recently moved. That's why Sam is smiling so big. He's got all of his boys together, and so we're glad to have them here and back with us. Caleb, go ahead and mention the things that you need to mention.
I'd just like to say thank you to all who donated items to sell at our yard sale, and also all those who came out and helped with it, those who came by and look to see if you wanted anything. I know that some of us didn't want anything from it, and I understand. But anyways, we had our yard sale yesterday. It was a huge success, and so thank you so much. I'll share with you, we made about $2,000 in fundraising from that, and so we're very happy about that, and just a little bit closer. So thank you again for everybody who helped out. I had parents there. I had we worked Roger extra hard yesterday, and then we were all out there just doing them. And it was a lot of fun. Thank you for all those who made sticky buns and cinnamon rolls, and we had coffee and lemonade, and all that was great. Thank you again to everybody who did that. I do have an order of business that I need to do. Will Ward, will you stand up right back there? He's back there in the sound booth. You'll see him back there. And then we have James Ward right here. Can you stand up, James? Just real quick. All right, so these two have come to me for baptism. They have been attending this church for all their life, okay? But they trusted Christ as their Savior several years ago, and now today they're going to follow the Lord in believers' baptism. And I need to open it up. I need a motion to accept them into membership upon baptism. Dave's first motion. Pastor Seidel seconds that motion. And then if you want to put Roger Ward as the third motion, that will work too. Third. All right? So that's it. We're going to vote them in as members upon their baptism at the end of the service. So now, at this time, that's all I have. Our missionaries of the week are Nathan and Christy Winters. Many of you know them. He used to be the associate pastor here years ago. Now they are at the family. He works for the Family Policy Alliance Institute of Wyoming, and he's down in Cheyenne on our behalf, working with the legislature. And we support them. We're going to pray for them at this time. Dearly Father, Lord, thank you for this day. Lord, thank you for our missionaries of the week this week, Nathan and Christy Winters. Thank you for their service down there. Lord, thank you for their desire to work there and work on our behalf down there in Cheyenne with the legislatures. Thank you for all the wisdom that you've given Nathan. Lord, I ask that you bless them this week. Lord, I ask that you help them through anything that's going on this week. Lord, thank you for them. Lord, we lift them up to you, put them in your hands. We ask you these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, at this time, I'm going to ask you to stand up one last time with me. We're trying to get pastor preaching here so that we're having the Lord's table and baptism. So we don't want him to preach too long today, okay? So hymn 281, Oh How I Love Jesus. All right, sing it out with us. Oh How I Love Jesus. first verse. There it is. Okay, ready? There is a name I love to hear. Sing it out.
There is a name I love to hear. I love to sing its word. It sounds like music in my ear. The sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first...
Ushers, come on that second stanza to take the offering. It tells of one whose loving heart. Sing it out.
It tells of one whose loving heart.
Brother Dell, before you sing, will you lead us in a word of prayer for the offering this morning?
Father, we thank you that you allowed us to live in America.
Yes, Father.
And what you made of America, we give you the honor and glory and praise. I've never went without a meal. I've always had a bed to sleep in. I've had a roof over my head and shoes on my feet.
Thank you,
Lord, thank you for these blessings, but most of all, thank you for dying on the cross for us and saving us from an awful ending. So bless this offering, Lord, and thank you for providing each one of us with the means. May you be honored and glorified with this money, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
In their robes of white array.
Turn in your Bibles, please, to the book of Romans, chapter 4. Text today is Romans 4, 18 through 21. While you're turning there, I'd like to dismiss the children to Children's Church. If you would come down here, for Pastor Caleb has a word for you.
Preaches the sermon up here today, Lord. Ask, fill him with your spirit, Lord. Ask you all these things. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. And if you'd stand for the reading of God's word, please, as they are going out. Romans 4, verse 18. Who against hope believed in hope, that he might become the father of many nations, according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. And being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead, when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able also to perform. Father, we do thank you for your blessings. We praise you for your goodness and your wonderful works of the children of men. We do give you the glory. We thank you. We lift up Pastor Tony today as he brings this message. May we grow in grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory both now and forever. Amen.
I want to speak this morning another one of our theme messages. Our theme this year is that he might increase, we might decrease. That's been our theme all year. And this month we're talking about increasing in faith. Okay. Increase. I want to speak on this, and I want to use Abraham as an example here. That's what Romans chapter 4 is talking about, how Abraham had faith. And so it's important for us to understand that. Notice verse 17, as it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations. That's God the Father speaking to Abraham. Before him whom ye believed, even God, who quickeneth the dead and called those things which be not as though they were, who against hope believed in hope, that he might become the father of many nations. And so Abraham had a promise. God let him wait about 25 years to fulfill that promise. That's tough. I don't like to wait. I don't know about you, but doctor's offices and grocery checkout lines are my two least favorite places. All right? And so Abraham had to wait to see God's fulfillment of his promise. In a book entitled Percy Ray, A Ray for God, a story of a southern evangelist, Percy Ray talks about a revival that broke out in Selmer, Tennessee, during one of his meetings. A revival meeting was held there once a year, and when the revival was held, the horses would be turned out in the field, the farmers left their fields, everyone came to the revival meeting. In that particular year, a terrible drought had struck West Tennessee. And the corn was twisted, the cotton was wilted, the creeks and wells had gone dry. Everyone was bothered about the drought, and there had not been a cloud in the sky for nearly 30 days. They couldn't get their mind on anything except how dry it was. There was an old deacon who had long whiskers, and he stroked those whiskers, and he said, "Brother preacher," he said, "we need to come in the morning and pray for rain. Everybody's mind's on the drought, not on revival. We're not going to have a revival if we don't get a rain. The animals are dying. The crops are dying. We just can't have a revival meeting. So let's all come in the morning and pray." And so they set the next morning as a prayer meeting. And when the old deacon came, he brought his hip boots and his raincoat with him. And as Percy
called them the Spit and Whittle Gang down at the country store. They saw the old man. They said, "Look yonder. Grandpa's gone crazy. He's so worried over the drought, he's losing his mind. He'd gone down the street with his hip boots and carrying an umbrella. There's not a cloud in the sky. He's been acting mighty peculiar lately. Now he's gone crazy over the drought." A little while later, the old deacon's wife and granddaughter came, and the granddaughter had her galoshes and a raincoat and was carrying an umbrella, and the Spit and Whittle Club, that's really not worth much of anything, shared their opinions. They said, "Honey, you and your grandpa have gone crazy. You got a pair of galoshes, a raincoat, an umbrella. Your grandpa just went up the street with his hip boots and a raincoat, and there's not a cloud in the sky, and there ain't going to be any rain today." She said, "What do you mean? Ain't you heard? Grandpa's gone to the church to pray till it rains. And I'm going to stay with him till it rains. We need these when we go home." And the people came to the church that day and they began to pray. They began by confessing sins and faults, and people began to make things right with one another and right with the Lord. And the old deacon got in the corner of the building and he put his face in the corner and he began to pray. And he began to beg God to send rain so they could have revival. He didn't pray for the crops. He didn't pray. He prayed for revival. The longer he prayed, the closer his face got to the corner of the auditorium. Tears ran down his whiskers and down on his chest as he prayed, and he kept on praying. In a little while, there was a rumbling heard outside. And then suddenly, a clap of thunder was heard. And the wind began to blow. And before noon, it came a flood. It washed down fences and cut gullies through fields. And when the old man went home, he was wearing his hip boots and carrying his granddaughter on his shoulder. And the water was so high, needless to say, they had revival. You know what faith is? Faith is when you wear your galoshes and raincoat to church when you're praying for rain. You believe that God is able and that God will hear. We're told, Jesus said, "Have faith in God," in Mark 11:22. And Paul said in Romans 14:23, "Whatsoever is not of faith is sin." He also said in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7, "For we walk by faith and not by sight." Folks, we need an increase in faith today. In our country, in our community, in our church, in our homes, and in our hearts. We need to trust God. We need to take God's word for what it is. We need to believe Him. There are two statements in the Bible about faith that always grip my heart when I read them. The first is in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. The Bible says, "But without faith it is impossible to please Him," speaking of God, "for he that cometh to God must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him." Now think about that for a moment. Christians, one of our desires is to please God. Yet if we don't have faith, we're not able to please God. When we come to God, we must believe that He is, that He exists, and we must not doubt His existence. Yet that's not enough. We must believe that He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. Too many of us pray one time, and if we don't get to the answer we want, we say, "God didn't answer my prayer. God's not interested in my prayer." We need faith to please God. When we come to God, we have to believe that He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. It's not enough to believe that God exists. Most of you know the name Albert Einstein. Once he was asked if there was a God, and he said, "Certainly there's a God. Any man who doesn't believe in a cosmic force is a fool, but we could never know Him," end of quote. There's no question that Einstein was a brilliant man, but when it came to about a knowledge of God, he was spiritually ignorant. You can know God. You can know Him through the person of His Son, and you can know Him through His Word today. And He's real. And you can have no shadow of a doubt that He's able. The second statement that always grips my heart is in Matthew 13:58, where the Bible says, "And He did not many mighty works there because of their unbelief." The root cause of why Jesus didn't do mighty works in His own hometown was because of unbelief. And how many times do we hinder the power of Almighty God because we just don't believe? God rewards those who have faith, and He withholds blessings and demonstrations of His power to those who don't have faith. Since faith is such an important ingredient, how can we have strong faith? How can we increase our faith? That's the question today. And I believe Abraham is a good example of a man who had strong faith. And I want us to look at what the Scripture says about Abraham. There's two things I want you to see, or three things I want you to see. First of all, the degree of our faith that's spoken of here in Romans chapter 4. Abraham's faith talks about a degree of faith. First, there's a sickly degree of faith. Look at verse 19 of our text. And being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. I want you to draw your attention to that little phrase, not weak in faith. That word weak speaks of something that is diseased or sickly, something that's not functioning like it should. The word specifically used here speaks of one being infirmed in the body, suffering from some disease or the consequences thereof. It's used in contrast to one who's healthy. That's the opposite. We could say that Abraham didn't have puny faith. On several occasions, Jesus spoke about people having little faith. That was displayed. There was the night when the disciples found themselves on a stormy sea. And Jesus said to them, "Why are you fearful, O ye of little faith?" Matthew 6:30. And when Peter began to sink, Jesus said, "O thou little of little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt?" Matthew chapter 14, verse 31. A sickly or weak faith is one in which there is little faith. The degree of faith is anemic. It's sickly. It's weak. The Bible says that Abraham was not weak in faith. We need to be strong in faith. We need to increase in faith. We need to believe God in these dark days in which we live. But there's a second thought here. We also notice in the text a strong degree of faith. The Bible says in verse 20, he staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God. Instead of having a weak faith, Abraham's faith was strong. Instead of having a sickly faith, Abraham's faith was healthy. An example of strong faith is seen in the centurion in Matthew chapter 8, who had a servant that was sick. And he sent the Jews to Jesus, and he said, "Would you ask Jesus to heal my servant?" And Jesus left where he was and began to come towards the centurion's home. And the centurion met him on the way, and he said, "Wait a minute." He said, "Lord, you didn't understand. I didn't expect you to come to my house. I don't feel like I'm worthy to have you to come under my roof. Lord, I'm a man under authority. I have 100 soldiers under me. And I say to one of my soldiers, 'Go,' and he goes. And to one of my servants, 'Do this,' and he doeth it. Lord, I just wanted you to say that my servant would be healed." And Jesus marveled. And he said, "I have not found so great a faith in all of Israel." The man that amazed Jesus because he had strong faith. How would you evaluate your faith today? Do you know the Word of God? Do you know faith is always based upon what God says? Do you know God's Word enough that you can claim a promise of God and see God answer His promise? Do you understand that? I'm sure most of you have heard the name Robert Louis Stevenson. He's the author of Treasure Island and many other well-known stories. What you probably don't know was that he grew up in a godly home and put his faith and trust in the Lord Jesus as a child. But there was a second fact. He was sickly, and as an adult, he was fighting a losing battle against a deadly disease. He wrote these words, quote, "Tragedy of things works itself out blacker and blacker. Does it shake my cast iron faith? I cannot say that it does." I believe in the ultimate decency of things. And if I woke in hell, I would still believe. End of quote. I want to ask you something. Do you have a cast iron faith? Do you have a faith that will not be shaken by circumstances that are not what you want? Not only the degree of faith, but I want you to notice secondly, notice a demonstration of faith. This passage tells us that Abraham's faith was demonstrated. Look first, notice how he looked at the problem. Verse 19 says, "And being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body, now dead, when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb." That particular situation being described revolves around the promise that God had given him. 25 years earlier, God said, "You're going to have a son. I'm going to bless, and through you, I'm going to bless this world, Abraham." But Abraham didn't have a son. He was 75 years old when he got the promise. Not usually the time that you want to go buy baby clothes. Okay? Not usually the time that you furnish a nursery. Man, I'm 63 and I love my grandchildren. But I tell you, I love to see them come, and I'm ready for them to go because I'm wore out and tired when they leave. You know? I can't imagine trying to raise kids at my age. My grandfather Newhouse had my father when he was 61 years old. I admire that man. Okay? Think about something. He didn't stagger at God's promise. 25 years had passed, and Abraham is still believing. Abram's near 100 years of age. Sarah is 90. I once heard someone describe what an optimist is. He said an optimist is a 90-year-old man that marries a 30-year-old woman and they buy a house next to an elementary school. That's an optimist. But there's a difference between faith and optimism. Optimism is a 90-year-old man and a 30-year-old woman. Faith is a 100-year-old man and a 90-year-old woman believing what God said. That's biblical faith. The Bible says that Abraham was very much aware of his limitations. He realized that his body was old, that it was now dead to the natural processes. He realized that Sarah's body was no longer able to conceive or carry a child, yet he believed what God said. That is biblical faith. He considered not the problem of the deadness of his body. He considered, it speaks of something observed fully. It speaks that he didn't just focus on the problem. Do you know what many Christians do? We look at the promises of God through the problems of life instead of looking at the problems of life through the promises of God. And there is a difference. Do you believe what God says? Do you trust and rest upon Him? A weak faith focuses on problems. When Philip is asked to give some bread to the people that have gathered to hear Jesus preach, he gets out his little abacus and he says 200 penny worth of bread would not give everybody just a bite. You see, he was looking at the problem instead of looking at the promise. And Jesus was the promise. His faith was weak and he demonstrated how not to respond to a situation. He looked at the problem and he said, "There's no way we can feed this bigger crowd." Some look at the problems and fall apart. They see no further than the human impossibility of the situation. Weak faith is always demonstrated in one who focuses on what they can or can't do rather than on what God can do. Weak faith only sees the problem and asks, "What will we do?" Weak faith fills the heart with fear. Weak faith sees nothing but the difficulties that the problem brings. I heard the story about an old poor Georgia farmer ragged and barefoot, he was standing next to the shack in which he lived, and a stranger stopped by for a drink of water, and he says, "How's your cotton coming along?" The farmer replied, "Ain't got none." "Didn't you plant any?" asked the stranger. "Nope," said the farmer, "afraid of the boll weevils." "Well, how about your corn? Did you plant corn?" "Nope, didn't plant any corn, afraid we weren't going to get no rain." "How about your potatoes? Did you plant any potatoes?" "Nope, didn't plant any taters, scared of them potato bugs." "Did you plant anything?" The man said, "No, I just played it safe." Some of you are trying to play it safe. You're afraid you'll look foolish if you grab a promise of God and hang on to it and say, "God said it and that settles it. I believe what God says." There are many who are afraid to obey God because they don't believe the promises of God. We as Christians ought to rest upon God's promises. In the case of Abraham, the Bible said he considered not his own body now dead, neither the deadness of Sarah's womb. Abraham's focus was not on his problem. His focus was not considering Sarah's age and his age. That didn't cause him fret and worry. He said, "God said that we're going to have a baby." And they started decorating the nursery, folks. We need some faith like that today. We need some faith that will believe that God means what He says and that it can be applied to us. The oldest mother that is recorded, Maria del Carmine Bosada de Lara, is the oldest verified mother. She was 66 years old, 358 days, when she gave birth to twin girls. She was 130 days older than Adriana Ilescu, who gave birth in 2005 to a baby girl. In Abraham's case, he was 35 years older than Maria. And Sarah was 24 years older than that Spanish mother. But from a human perspective, they had a problem. Yet they didn't look at the problem. What did he do? He leaned on the promise. He leaned on the promise. He was not considering the problem, but rather God's promise. He did not demonstrate weak faith by sitting around worrying about his problem. Instead, he demonstrated strong faith by leaning upon what God had said. I'm here to tell you that God's promises are true. In my old Bible, I've got little marks next to Bible verses. Just three initials. STP. Say, you put an oil treatment in your Bible? Now, that's not what STP stands for. It stands for Scripture Tried and Proved. Where I've had to come before God and say, "God, this is what You've promised." One of those verses in Psalm where David said in Psalm 37:25, "I've been old and now I'm young, but I've never seen the righteous forsaken nor the seed begging bread." There was a time when I couldn't take care of my family and didn't have enough money and got down on my face and said, "God, David said that You would take care of those that trust You." And inside of 2 days, I went out to the mailbox and there was a check for $200. And I went to the grocery store. You said, "Man, that's exciting." It was afterwards. I was scared half to death. My Bible, so I wouldn't forget, I put STP. Scripture Tried and Proved. And all throughout my Bible, there are verses that I claim. I'm here today to challenge you. Those promises are good for you, just like they were good for me. But you've got to know them and you've got to be willing to claim them and believe them by faith. That's how God answers prayer. You know, while this was going on, Abraham's name was Abram. I want you to think about that. You know what that name means? It means high father or exalted father. Every time somebody called Abram's name, they reminded him that he was named High Father, Exalted Father. And then God changed his name and made him Abraham. Old Mays Jackson was a Southern evangelist. He said Abraham learned how to tithe and God put Ham on his name. You learn how to tithe, God will give you some ham too. Abraham. And that meant father of a multitude. Can you imagine going up to somebody and introducing you? Hi, I'm Abraham. How are you doing?
Good.
Oh, your name means father of a multitude. How many kids have you got? Well, don't have any kids. Every time someone said Abram or Abraham, he was reminded of the fact that he didn't have any children, but he had God's promise. God said, you're going to have children. They're going to be like the stars in the sky, like the sand by the seashore, like the dust of the earth, Abraham. God reminded him. In verse 21, it says, and being fully persuaded that what he, speaking of God, had promised, he was able also to perform. He was absolutely resting upon what God had said. Have you done that? Are you willing to do that? When I was going to Bible school, I learned a name I hadn't heard before. His name was George Mueller. George Mueller was a reprobate man. His father wanted him to be a lawyer. He became a drunk. But God saved him. Later in life, he moved from Germany to England, to Bristol, England. If you ever get a chance to read the biography, Mueller of Bristol, you ought to. Through the years, by faith alone, George Mueller built an orphanage there to take care of the orphan, the street kids of England. And by faith alone, he fed those children. I mean, there were times when Mr. Mueller would get up in the morning and there was no bread to eat. And he'd begin to pray and a bread wagon would break down out in front of the church, out in front of the orphanage. And come in and said, I can't get to market. Can you use this bread? Other times, the dairyman couldn't get his milk to cry. God took care of him. And through the years, Mueller fed and clothed and housed and raised over 2,000 orphans. But Mueller had this. He said, I'm never going to ask anybody for money for the orphans. He said, I'm only going to ask God. And he never asked anybody but God. He said, I want to be an example to this generation of what God can do in the life of a man that will trust Him. And you read that book, man, oh man, you talk about feeling manipulative and trying to get what you want through your means. I tell you, it humbled me. Faith, believing the promises of God, God's able. One last thing, and I'm going to close. The development of our faith. Our memory verses this morning, one of them is in Luke 17, where the apostles turned to the Lord and they said, Lord, increase our faith. The word increase means to place additionally, to add to. The idea of one's faith being developed and made stronger. The tense of the word strong in faith in Romans 4:20 is that Abraham's faith was becoming stronger. He was growing in faith. He was increasing in faith. How do you and I increase in faith? Two thoughts this morning. Number one, ask God to increase your faith. Just as the disciples did, we need to ask God to increase our faith. Look with me at Mark chapter 9, if you would. It's a story of a man who brought his son that was possessed of demons. Jesus came down from the Mount of Transfiguration with Peter, James, and John, and he found his disciples surrounded by a crowd and being questioned by the scribes. He asked them what was going on, and one of the crowd stepped forward in verses 17 and 18 and said, Master, I've brought unto thee my son, which hath a dumb spirit, wherewith he taketh him and teareth him, and he foameth and gnasheth with his teeth and pineth away. And I spake to thy disciples that they should cast him out, and they could not. What was Jesus' response? In verse 19, he says, He answered him and said, O faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you? Bring him unto me. Jesus' assessment of the inability of His disciples as well as the attitude of the crowd was that they were faithless. The situation served to give Jesus the opportunity to teach a valuable lesson. He said to the Father in verse 23, "If thou believest, all things are possible to him that believeth. If thou canst," implying that there was no doubt. In James 1:6, "But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering." You ask God, you don't waver. You believe Him. Doubt and faith are like oil and water. They don't mix. There cannot be doubt if there's faith, and there cannot be faith if there's doubt. I draw your attention to verse 24. "And straightway the father of the child cried out with tears, Lord, I believe. Help thou my unbelief." He was asking the Lord to increase his faith. One of the things that we can do is to ask God to increase our faith. Maybe you feel weak in faith. Maybe you feel overwhelmed by the circumstances of life. Maybe it's physical problems. Maybe it's family problems. Maybe it's financial problems. But you've not gotten to the Word and found a promise of God that you can claim as your own and made it your own. You've not exercised faith on what God has said. Let me encourage you to do that. Ask God to increase your faith and get in the Word. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Are you willing to say, "I believe, help thou my unbelief"? I can tell you honestly, I've prayed that prayer on more than one occasion. There have been times where I didn't know how I was going to take care of situations. And I've turned to the Lord and I said, "Lord, I believe. You know I believe, but help thou my unbelief." Ask Him to increase your faith. But then secondly, allow Him to increase your faith. There's one thing that I've discovered, that when my faith needs to increase, God puts me in a situation where all I can do is trust Him. It's scary to live by faith. God will stretch you and He'll stretch me and He'll cause us to grow and He'll give us opportunities to grow. God will put me in a situation where I have to have faith in Him. In James 1, verses 2 and 3, "My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptation, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience." James tells us that trials are productive in the life of a believer. It results in God growing and increasing our faith. One of the things that the trying of our faith produces is stronger faith. I think of the words of the Andre Crouch song, "Through It All." Listen to the words that this man wrote. "I've had many tears and sorrows. I've had questions for tomorrow. There have been times I didn't know right from wrong, but in every situation, God gave blessed consolation that my trials only come to make me strong. So I thank God for the mountains, and I thank Him for the valleys. I thank Him for the storms He's brought me through. Because if I never had a problem, I wouldn't know that He could solve them. I wouldn't know what faith in His Word can do. Through it all, I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God. Through it all, I've learned to depend upon His Word." You see, the very thing that increases our faith are those difficult situations that we don't want. Those problems that intrude into our life that we never asked for. The things that cause us to wonder and notice our lack of ability and our lack of resources to handle the situation. It's then that you and I can trust Him and His promises completely and make them our own. A strong faith doesn't just happen. It's developed over years as God brings you and me to places that we have to trust Him. It's therefore incumbent on us to allow Him to increase our faith, to allow Him to work in our lives, not to get upset, not to blame Him for things that we don't know. In closing, turning to 2 Thessalonians and the testimony of the Thessalonian believers, Paul said in 2 Thessalonians 1:3, We are bound to thank God always for you, brethren, as it is meet, because that your faith groweth exceedingly. Here's the question. Paul said to the believers at Thessalonica, he said, we're bound to thank God for you because you're growing, you're increasing in your faith. It's growing exceedingly. Do you want that to be your testimony? That you're growing and increasing in faith? If you do, then you know what? You need to ask God to help you increase in faith. And you need to allow God to help you increase in faith. Let's look to the Lord in a word of prayer. I'm going to dismiss Pastor Caleb and the young men that are going to get baptized. They're going to slip back and get ready. And then just as soon as they're baptized, we're going to observe the Lord's table. And if you would like to remember the death, burial, resurrection of Christ, what He did for you, our deacons will share the elements that remind us of His great work. But let's close in prayer. Lord, You know us. You know that we like to depend upon ourselves, our abilities, our resources. And yet, Lord, we need to increase in faith. If You're ever going to increase and we're going to decrease, then we as Your people need to increase in faith. We need to learn how to find the promises of God in the Word of God. We need to find out how to claim those promises and make them our own. And Lord, in this invitation, I pray that You'd speak to hearts. Lord, help us not to be satisfied with a weak faith, a faith that stumbles at the promises of God instead of stand strong and said, this is what God says, and I believe it, and I'm going to rest on it, regardless of what happens. The world calls that foolishness, but Lord, You call it faith when we claim Your promises. Help us to do that today. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Pastor Seidel, would you come and lead us in an invitation hymn? Would you stand with me this morning? If God's spoken with you about your faith, whether or not you're trusting God and resting in God, why don't you come down here and say, Lord, increase my faith. Help me to grow in faith. Pastor.
We're going to sing, All to Jesus I Surrender. There needs to be in all of our lives an opportunity for us to make that decision to say, Lord, I surrender this doubt. I surrender this question. And so as we give the invitation this morning, we invite you to come. If we could have that on the screen, Doug. All to Jesus I Surrender. All to Jesus. Would you come this morning, make your way to the altar, and give God that opportunity to work in your life.
Surrender all
to Thee, my
blessed Savior. I surrender all.
I want to tell you a story before we sing another song. I have about 13 men in my Sunday school class. Would you guys raise your hand if you're in my Sunday school class? Look around, you'll see these men. Last Sunday morning, we met together as a prayer group to pray for an irrigation pump at my place.
Amen.
We've worked on it for weeks. We asked God for wisdom to know how to fix it. Sunday afternoon, it was fixed.
Amen.
We knew what to do. It's just one of those things. You need to trust God to answer simple prayers like fixing an irrigation pump, saving somebody, meeting your needs. Let's sing one more stanza before we turn it over to Brother Caleb.
All to Jesus.
Would you come this morning, meet God at the altar, and give Him that part of your life.
I bow.
Well, we're excited to be here with Will and James Ward. I talked to Will and James this last week about their testimonies of salvation. I talked to Will about 2 weeks ago, I think it was. And I talked to James, and they both, we went through the Bible, and we talked about what it means to be saved, and they both given a testimony to where it's without a doubt that they have trusted Christ as their Savior. At this time, we're going to do the baptism. Baptism is a step of obedience, but we have to understand when we trust Christ as our Savior, it's an inward decision between us and the Lord. When we get baptized, it's a public statement that I am saved and that I'm following the Lord. So today when these two get baptized, it's a public statement for you all that Will and James Ward have decided to follow the Lord. And they've already made that decision and they're following him now. So we're going to go ahead and do that. Will, have you trusted Christ as your Savior?
Yes.
Well, on that public test.
Isn't that awesome?
Amen.
Maybe if you're here and you haven't yet followed the Lord in believer's baptism, that's something you need to do. And how do I know if the Lord's telling me to do that? If you feel a tugging right here that you should do that, then that's what you should do. This time, would the men come who are going to prepare for the Lord's table, and we'll begin to have that service. If you do not want to join with us, we allow you to